It's time for the Phil Ferguson Show.
Buddy, this is Phil Ferguson, and you are listening to The Phil Ferguson Show, episode 227. It's early, almost middle of September, and we're getting ready for the big Halloween season coming up. And later in the show, we're going to talk with Margee Kerr. She is an expert on fear and why people, humans, have fear of things. So you're going to enjoy that an awful lot, I think. We're also going to talk about NSOs, in this case, it's non-qualified stock options, request by a couple of different listeners, because a few weeks ago I talked about employee stock purchase plans, and they pointed out I've never talked about these. The other thing that I've never talked about, and I've had a few requests in the past, are binary stock options. So we're going to talk about those things, and then we'll go talk about fear. So let's start with non-qualified stock options. I think one thing I don't warn people enough about when doing this show is you cannot take investment advice from a podcast. Please never, ever do that, whether it's mine or some other one. It's just educational, maybe a little entertaining, but do not take investment advice. This is not to be considered investment advice, but hopefully educational. So non-qualified stock options are another method of inducement, possibly even income for you as an employee for a company. Very frequently, these are offered by younger, smaller companies that maybe don't have the capital to pay you what you're theoretically worth, but can give you something that promises to be worth a whole lot more money at some point in the future. And it's also often used as an inducement for you to stay a period of time so the company doesn't have to keep replacing you and hiring new people and training new people. And so you've got these stock options that are out there in the future. So with non-qualified stock options, one of the things that can be real simple is that there is usually a strike price that they're set at, say $40 a share. And that can be the price at the time they give them to you. It can be a price set at some other time. And then at that point in time or some future date or multiple future dates, sometimes over 3, 4, 5 years even, you have the option to sell some part or different lots or batches of those shares at the then market price. So let's just say the price is set at $40 and you have some stock that are now qualified, whatever the rules are for your specific plan, and you can sell them and the market price of the stock is $100. So you can buy $40,000 worth of stock, say, as an example, if you can buy that many shares, and they're suddenly spontaneously worth $100,000. Now, the big question is, what do you do with them? If you turn around and sell them, immediately the $60,000 that you made will be counted as ordinary income and added to your income. However, if you hold them for more than a year, you might pay capital gains on some or all of that. And that's where it gets tricky because there's other rules and sub-rules. And I genuinely cannot answer that question for you. So it is something you should, I insist, that you seek out a enrolled agent, a CPA, someone who's qualified in taxes to walk you through the possibilities and the permutations of what are the pros and cons of paying taxes now or paying taxes later. If there's not a big effect on the taxes, so let's pretend like you've already resolved that with your accountant, what your tax options, what your tax choices are, because I don't want to use the word options in multiple ways, what your tax ramifications might be. Okay, now you have that information from them. For me, I generally look at these things in a couple of ways. One, it's found income. If you spent $40,000 and you could buy them for $40,000 and sell them for $100,000, you made $60,000 extra freaking dollars. Sell it, pay the tax, and be done with it. You just made an extra $60,000. Even if your tax rate is 33 1/3 and you've got to pay 20 in taxes, you still get to pocket $40,000. There are a lot of people who would be really happy just pocketing an extra $40,000. That's fantastic. You can spend that money or invest it. I would be inclined to recommend that you invest it because you didn't need the money before. Why spend it now? But that's just me. If you hold it, now you're taking an additional factor, additional risk, plus or minus, on the future value of the company. And that's something only you can make a guess at, and you can be wrong, very, very wrong. If you think that the company is going to keep going up, 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 your $100,000 turns into $120,000, $140,000, $150,000. And now you're investing in or taking your risk with that specific company. I generally recommend not more than 5% of your portfolio be in a specific stock. 10%, if you really, really think you know what's going on, which is often just self-deceit because you don't really know what's going on. And if you work for the company and all of your money is in the company stock and something happens, whether it's embezzlement or loss of a patent right or a new regulation with the government, and suddenly the company can't make money, you get laid off and your stock collapses, you lose your job, you lose your portfolio, all in the same couple of days. That sucks. That's really, really bad. That's real, genuine risk. If you had sold that for the $100,000 and paid the $20,000 in tax, of course, you had to have $40,000 to buy it. You've now got $80,000 that you can invest. If you lose your job and the company goes broke, you still have the $80,000. The real thing that freaks people out is, what if? What if the stock doubles or triples or quadruples or quintuples? You could make an awful lot of money with a very small investment. That's true of any stock. And I have to stick with my basic advice, is you shouldn't put a whole lot of your money in one specific stock. So if you have a big portfolio and $100,000 is 5% of your portfolio and you want to let it ride, fine. Of course, that means you have a $2 million portfolio. Anything shy of that, you should sell it. Now, you can keep some, so you don't have to sell all of it. This is not a binary choice. We'll talk about binary options in a few minutes, but you don't have to sell every single share. You could sell enough shares to cover your $40,000 that you put in, plus whatever you might have to pay tax on that gain, and then let the rest ride. That could lower the amount that you have invested quite considerably, but still try to not go over the 5, or if you have to, the 10% of your total portfolio, which can be really hard if this is a great thing. The other thing is that if you're close to retirement, 5-10 years from retirement, and you think this is the one thing that you're going to roll the dice on, it's finally going to make you rich, there's a good chance you're going to be very saddened because it might not work out. Young companies fail. A lot of young companies fail. Some succeed beyond your wildest dreams, and it's amazing. And that I see as more of a possibility for someone who's 25 or 30 or 35. Because if it doesn't work out, you've still got 20, 30 plus years to fix it. If you're a few years from retirement, it's going to be really tricky. And it also depends, do you have more stock options that qualify or aren't qualified stock options that come due in the future? And maybe you can take advantage of the rise in the stock's value with the future execution of additional options. So it's really tricky to think about. My default, and this is just me and your situation is different, take the money, pay the tax, and be freaking happy. And then spread it across your investment like everything else and just move forward slow and steady. I like to think of my method of investing in the terms of the tortoise and the hare fable, I guess. Is that what we call it? I want to be the turtle. Slow and steady. Invest in the total stock market. Invest in all stocks. Invest in all international stocks. Invest in all kinds of different types of bonds. Diversify your risk. Diversify, diversify. Save more money. Spend less money. Wait longer. And in the end, it's all going to work out. So I kind of lean towards that. you want to keep a small part of it because you think the company is going to pop, fine. Keep some of the shares. Sell enough to cover your taxes and your expenses and the money you put in, and make sure you don't have too much in the stock. Because if the stock really pops and you kept $20,000 and it goes up 10 times, you have $200,000. You can cry that you didn't make the million, but your other money still probably invested over time did all right, and your $20,000 turned into $200,000. You're still doing well. But if that $20,000 and the company goes broke, you lose the $20,000, but all your other money is still invested. So you're kind of win either way. You're not playing for as big a win or as big a loss, because we don't want to get wiped out, especially if you're 5 or 10 years from retirement. So that's some thoughts on non-qualified stock options. Our next thing we're going to talk about is another word, use of the word options, which is a dicey word in the investment world, is binary options. I don't even think these things have the right name. I don't even see them as options. What I see them as, a bet. You're going to bet on the value of something. It can be a stock, a bond, it can be gold, silver, pork bellies, it can be almost anything. And you can set a price. So let's say you're looking at a stock that's trading at $55 a share today. And at a certain fixed point in the future, whether it's later today, or a couple of weeks, or a couple of months, you can sell, or you can buy a binary option that says the stock is or is not going to be at $60. It's a bet. And if you win the bet, then you get some money. If you lose the bet, you lose money. It's straightforward. It's kind of a 50-50. Now, it depends. You know, you can have on the same stock at the same time multiple binary options at $56, $60, $64, $70. And the price you might pay for them might be higher or lower. The price you might sell them might be higher or lower. And it gets very, very complicated. And it can be very confusing. And it's something I'm not going to go into a whole lot of detail because of this. But you're basically turning the stock market into something that on an average year, you bet $100, you're going to make $110 because the stock market goes up 10%. The binary options, by definition, between the buyer and the seller are a zero-sum game. So you're turning something, the stock market, which regularly goes up in value, you're now creating binary options where you're either going to make money or you're not going to make money. It's a 50-50. You have to be right more often than not. Now, if you have some area of expertise and maybe specific knowledge about a resource or a stock, maybe you could make money in this. But it's very, very specific, and it's something that I will very specifically recommend that you do not do. So you're going to do these binary options, if you so choose to do, and you either make money or you lose money. Like I said, it's 50-50. That's why they're binary. It's yes or no. You either make money or you lose the money if you sell a binary option. So it takes the risk of the market going up and down kind of out in a way. And all your risk is based on the specific thing, which goes contrary to my philosophy and what I said just a few minutes ago about diversification. So that's a really crude, very shorthand version of what binary options are, because I don't really want to go into it too much because I'm afraid that you might think it's a good thing to do. It is not. Do not get binary options. There's all kinds of websites you can go and read, and they talk about how you can make a ton of money in binary options. Yeah, if you're right all the time, or a majority of the time. And if you're just someone who dabbles in a few stocks or hopefully has a bunch of index funds, what do you know about these things? It's too tricky. It's something I know a lot, I think, about the industry. I would never be interested in doing these because it can quickly get out of hand. So that's something about binary options. If you have more questions, let me know and we could look into a specific thing if there's something going on, or probably more likely to, for average listeners, if you have non-qualified stock options or other questions, you can email me, phil@polarisfinancialplanning.com. And in just a minute, we're going to take a little break and go into our interview. But I was just thinking about this because earlier today, totally off topic, this is just Phil, something that's going on in Phil's world. I'm trying to work on my lawn, and I put down copper because I'm concerned that the soil that I have for my lawn is shit. Actually, it's not shit. It's bad. It doesn't have proper nutrients. So earlier in the year, I added iron. Now I added copper. And the funny thing is I'm sensitive to a lot of smells. And so now I feel like I went swimming in a pool, a giant pool of pennies, and I cannot. I've taken two showers. I even had one of these very rigid, bristly brushes scrubbing my hands and arms, trying to get the smell off, and it's driving me nuts. I smell like a copper penny, but I guess that's what you get when you spread copper on your lawn. So hopefully the shit works and makes my lawn thicker and greener, but I've been working on the lawn and dethatching and raking the crap out of it and putting seeds down, and all of a sudden it looks like summer's kind of over. So now in this little bit northern climate with Chicago, you know, we're going to have some nights in the 50s and highs in the low 70s, even highs in the upper 60s. Suddenly, there's only now 4 to 6, maybe 8 weeks for grass to germinate and grow. So got to get the seed down, got to see what I can get to grow before the long, long, cold winter comes. Somewhere in this game, I've got to find a place to live in the South or figure out how to vacation better. But anyway, enough fun with that. I am going to take a little break, or you're going to take a little break, listen to something fun, and we'll go into our interview right after that.
Reverend Mesa, Reverend Rock,
I'm grateful for your generous invitation to state my views. While the so-called religious issue is necessarily and properly the chief topic here tonight, I want to emphasize from the outset that I believe that we have far more critical issues in the 1960 campaign. The spread of communist influence until it now festers only 90 miles from the coast of Florida. The humiliating treatment of our president and vice president by those who no longer respect our power. The hungry children I saw in West Virginia. The old people who cannot pay their doctor's bills. The families forced to give up their farms, and America with too many slums, with too few schools, and too late to the moon and outer space. These are the real issues which should decide this campaign. And they are not religious issues for war and hunger and ignorance and despair. No, no religious barrier. But because I am a Catholic, and no Catholic has ever been elected president, the real issues in this campaign have been obscured, perhaps deliberately, in some quarters less responsible than this. So it is apparently necessary for me to state once again, not what kind of church I believe in, for that should be important only to me, but what kind of America I believe in. I believe in an America where the separation of church and state is absolute, where no Catholic prelate would tell the president, should he be Catholic, how to act. And no Protestant minister would tell his parishioners for whom to vote. When no church or church school is granted any public funds or political preference. And when no man is denied public office merely because his religion differs from the president who might appoint him or the people who might elect him. I believe in an America that is officially neither Catholic, Protestant, nor Jewish, when no public official either requests or accepts instructions on public policy from the Pope, the National Council of Churches, or any other ecclesiastical source, when no religious body seeks to impose its will, directly or indirectly, upon the general populace or the public acts of its officials, and where religious liberty is so indivisible that an act against one church is treated as an act against all. For while this year it may be a Catholic against whom the finger of suspicion is pointed, in other years it has been, and may someday be again, a Jew, or a Quaker, or a Unitarian, or a Baptist. It was Virginia's harassment of Baptist preachers, for example, that led to Jefferson's statute of religious freedom. Today I may be the victim, but tomorrow it may be you.
until the whole fabric of our harmonious society is ripped apart at a time of great national peril. Finally, I believe in an America where religious intolerance will someday end, where all men and all churches are treated as equals, where every man has the same right to attend or not to attend the church of his choice, where there is no Catholic vote, no anti-Catholic vote, no block voting of any kind, and where Catholics, Protestants, and Jews, at both the lay and the pastoral levels, will refrain from those attitudes of disdain and division, which have so often marred their works in the past, and promote instead the American ideal of brotherhood. That is the kind of America in which I believe.
I want to thank you for listening to The Phil Ferguson Show. It is a unique combination of one-third finance and two-thirds atheism. The show is number one in that category. I want to promote the philosophy of science-based investing. Sadly, most advisors are paid commissions by a big company to sell you investments that underperform. Sometimes they make more money with your money than you do. I think the financial services industry is a lot like religion. They create fear. They provide a solution to that fear. They take your money, and they often get more benefit from it than you do. Remember, people work for who they are paid by. You want a fiduciary advisor that is paid only by you. If you have questions about investments, want to roll over an old 401k, or need to make a plan to build your very own everlasting nest egg, you may contact me, Phil, at PolarisFinancialPlanning.com. Together, we can protect children from religion, promote a secular worldview, fight the grip religion has on our society, and improve your financial future. All right, everybody, welcome back. This is Phil Ferguson, and of course, you are still listening to The Phil Ferguson Show. With me now, I have Margee Kerr. How are you?
Good. How are you doing? So good to be here.
Oh, well, you're very kind. And you and I have been convention buddies, for at least table buddies, for a couple of conferences now, haven't we?
We have. And as soon as I see your table now, I know I'll set up right next to you because I know it'll be a good convention.
Well, I'm in a bit of a dilemma, and the listeners, maybe I'll put in the end of the show. By the time this show goes out, I will have gone to and hopefully returned from the American Atheist Conference. Are you going, by the way?
I'm not. I believe that's coming up, right? And this is getting into the haunted Halloween season, which means my schedule quickly fills up.
Well, that's excellent. Well, my little bit of scare is that I don't know if I actually got a table or not. And because the convention is in a couple of days, I can't seem to get a hold of anybody. So now I'm scared. If I take stuff, I'm wasting valuable weight and space in my bag on the plane. If I don't take stuff, I don't have things and they have a table and it looks embarrassing. So I don't know how to handle that yet. But anyway, we're talking in August, but this is probably going to be up close to the end of August, maybe September. And you mentioned Halloween. So tell us, what have you got planned? Where are you going to be? Maybe listeners can find you or go see you somewhere.
Yeah. So busy schedule right now. I'm in Philadelphia and I'll be working in Philly, doing some consulting gigs, doing a lot of surveys with Terror Behind the Walls at Eastern State Penitentiary, which is a very large haunted attraction. And then I will be going to Texas for a speaking engagement, and then Utah and Idaho. So I'm going to be spending some time in the Midwest and some states that I've never been to, and I'm very curious to check out and see what the local culture is like.
Well, time in Utah and Idaho definitely sounds scary to me.
Yeah. I've never been to either of those states, and I very interested to see how it goes.
Well, before we get too much into it, the listeners might be wondering, why are we talking about all this scary stuff? So why don't you tell us a little bit about your official title, your background, your degree, your research, and of course, the book.
Yes. Yeah, so I am a sociologist. I earned my PhD in 2009 from University of Pittsburgh, and I'm also an author. I published a book called Scream, Chilling Adventures in the Science of Fear. The paperback just came out this spring, and it's all about how and why people choose to engage with thrills and chills. So I look at the history, the psychology, the motivation to do these scary things, and how it's very culturally influenced. And I'm also a teacher, so I have a full course load this fall too. So I keep very busy.
Well, that's good. I'm just looking at your webpage, which is margeekerr.com. So that's pretty easy. For the listeners, it's margeekerr.com. And I did happen to notice it says I'm writing my new book Scream on there. So,
oh, I should update that.
You may need an update on that.
Yeah. My website definitely needs a little
change. I've been there and done that, and it's one of those things. It finally got to the point where keeping up with all of the things I needed to learn to run a website, I just didn't have the time for it. So I finally broke down and hired somebody because I don't have the time to research 4 hours to solve something that someone else can do in 5 minutes.
Yes, that is what I should do, and I will add that to my list.
Well, there you go. Well, if you want the name of somebody when we're off the show, remind me, and I can tell you.
Oh, thank you.
But this book, Scream, you're talking about fear and how it works, and you said people seek it out? Talk to me about that.
Yeah, when I first started looking at fear, it was mainly from the perspective of how it works in society to, keep people apart, how it's often used either in politics or in social movements. My dissertation was on how parents organized around the idea that vaccines cause autism, and I looked at how fear was a very big part of, getting people on board with that agenda. And I worked in research looking at, racism and discrimination and how fear is often behind that. But at the same time, we have this huge industry in the U.S. and people like myself enjoy, doing scary things on purpose and even paying for them. So I really wanted to look at fear from every angle to understand how it works, not just in society, but at a physical level, how we, construct what we're afraid of, how we deal with it, and why we would voluntarily, seek out scary things. And so it was really it's been a very revealing journey. And it really has helped me understand not just fear, but all emotions in such a more holistic way, which I think is really needed right now. In society, as emotions are so high, I think we should all have a better understanding of how they're working in our bodies and how our emotions play into all of the politics.
Oh, absolutely. I love it. And we can talk more about that. I want to circle back around because I know my listeners' ears perked up, at least mine did. When you mentioned vaccines and autism, would it be correct? My kind of thought on this is that the parents seek out this information and end up getting or not getting vaccinations, not because they intend to hurt their child. So approaching it that way is nonsensical from their perspective, but they're afraid they might actually harm their child, and the vaccine protects them from something that they don't see anymore, like whooping cough or polio. It, in their world, in the 25-year-old mom and dad world, they probably never in their entire lives seen those things. They don't exist, but they do know people that have autistic kids. What do you think about that? Flesh that out a little for me.
I think it's such a from start to finish with the anti-vax movement, fear is the driver. When parents see that something is wrong with their child and they go looking for answers because that uncertainty, the unknown factor, the oh my gosh, what is wrong, and search for calls is very human. We want to know. We want to reduce our our uncertainty because that's what makes us afraid. And they go online, and this was back, I started this research back in 2004, and I never thought that this would still be an issue by the time I finished my dissertation. But of course, it continues to come back. But that fear, you know, drives parents to go online to find answers, and they find this movement that says, oh, this is what did it. This is what caused, you know, your child's problems. And we're going to make you feel really good because now you know it's not your fault and you have an answer. Not good, I should say, but at least not, you know, left in that space of uncertainty. And then, you know, they go on to promote the movement. And all they need to say is, hey, do you want your kid to get sick, you know? And that it hits people at such a personal, emotional level. And it's not hard to, you know, change a parent's mind when they say, well, there's no chance that my child's going to get whooping cough, but there's a chance if I, you know, give this vaccine, they'll get sick. And it's a false, you know, it's a false choice in their minds, but they go with the safer decision that reduces any fear or anxiety. And then what you said about the lack of real experience with these tragic contagious diseases is real. I mean, we don't have any conception, at least people, you know, who are young and, you know, 30s, 40s. I mean, these illnesses have been absent from our reality for so long. But, you know, coming from a public health and medical sociology background, you know, and seeing the pictures and the devastation that these things brought to communities is really scary to think that we could end up back there if herd immunity drops and if, you know, enough parents start not vaccinating their kids. So I was really passionate about it. And one of the things that struck me, though, is a lot of the parents, they don't do it intentionally. I don't think that they try and scare other parents into the decision. I think that they're genuinely, you know, scared for other kids, but it's just based on bad science and based on, you know, acting from fear instead of, you know, sound medical advice.
Well, and so one of the things I was wondering is that if people behave in response to that fear, which I don't know if I want to call it rational, reasonable response, something I might do if I had poor information or sought out and happened to get poor information, would it be better to find a way to promote the illnesses? I mean, not by spreading them, but promote knowledge of the illnesses, making sure that every parent before they go get vaccinations sees a video of a child with whooping cough so that that scares them even more.
Right.
Than autism. Because, you know, in my perspective, and it's easy for me to say having two adultish children, if my choice was polio, whooping cough, or autism for my child, I wouldn't want polio or whooping cough. I might be okay with autism over polio. Maybe we need to scare the crap out of them even more on the other side.
That's it's something I think about a lot, and I'm glad you brought it up because I don't get asked this question a lot, but I do think about it. Like, is it then, you know, should we start scaring people in the other direction? And I think that there's it's something to be considered and weighed, because I'll tell you, when my friend had her baby and I went to see her in the hospital, before you leave, and parents out there will know this, you have to watch a video on shaken baby syndrome. And it's a video to teach parents not to shake their kids. And it's terrifying. And after you watch that video, I can't imagine any parent is going to shake their child. And so I think of that, like, well, maybe we need to make some of these things a little more real, but it's tough because then, you know, that has problems too. I mean, in a perfect world, people would act with patient, rational thought with these big decisions. But I think that there is a need for everybody to recognize the real threat, even though it's not there. And finding a way to do that is tough. Because I think about that too with climate change. We've got all of these big threats to us that are very different than the world we evolved in. You know, we had mostly very clear present threats, bears and the natural environment, you know, thunderstorms, snow. But today, things like climate change and cancer and even autism, where you don't know what is going to happen for a long time, how do you create that sense of immediacy? to communicate the power of a decision. And so, yeah, the short answer is I don't know, but I think about it, and I think about ways that you could maybe effectively turn it around and use fear in the other way.
Well, because it's an interesting thing in what I do. I often make the analogy that at least particularly the insurance industry, what they want to do is make you terrified of the loss that you might have, and that fear then drives you and can overpower the rational thought process of evaluating what you're buying.
Yeah. And it does in a very real way. I mean, when we think about how our brain works and how it prioritizes information, you know, it's going to act on the thing that is the most scary. And for most of our history, that's been to our advantage. And now, you know, as we get into more cerebral kind of long-term planning, it can work against us.
Now, one of the other things that you do, you help set up haunted houses. What does that mean? You help set them up, or what, you're a consultant? Walk me through that, please.
Yeah. So I originally got into working with haunted houses through conducting customer feedback surveys, just finding out what they liked and what they didn't like, you know, why they were going. And that transitioned into, you know, doing some consulting on how to design really good scares, you know, using what I've learned from my own research and from different, you know, studies just on human behavior, how to use that information to create scenes and sets and, you know, entire storylines that will scare people in a way that is fun and empowering rather than, you know, traumatizing. That's always been my big thing, is that I like haunted houses that make you feel like a hero, you know, at the end of a big adventure rather than a victim. So a lot of the work that I've done is helping designers think about those types of issues. And then just with the more fun stuff, like, oh, you know, people respond really actively to big eyes and, you know, this is the scariest monster of the moment and things like that that are a lot of fun. And that definitely helps me, you know, integrate my creativity and imagination into some of the science.
Now, one of the things we talked about pre-show, I told you that I don't want guests to punch down, and you actually knew what that meant. Can you talk about how that applies, and maybe even what it means if the listeners aren't sure, how that applies to the haunted house? Because I'm fascinated by that.
Yeah. One of the things that always frustrated me growing up, I've been going to haunted houses since I was a little kid, is going into a haunted house and immediately seeing every scene of, you know, a woman being decapitated or a woman being berated and all of these very offensive and exploitive scenarios that we don't need to use, that they're not needed. You know, I don't need to see another woman being beaten. It's not scary to me. It's not fun. It takes me out of the experience. And a lot of my female friends and male friends too are tired of those old tropes. And so when I talk to actors and when I do actor training and even consulting with designers, I use the punch down, you know, principle that when you're designing a scare, think about the power dynamics and you don't punch down. So if you want to have a scene that is, you know, a bloody, gory kind of murder scene, think about what the power dynamics are, who your demographic is, and flip the script. You know, maybe it's, you know, turning the dynamic around and having women in positions of power and creating scenarios that don't even have to include a victim. You know, you can create really scary scenes that are more based in kind of adventure and survival that are still gruesome and bloody and scary, but not at the expense of especially a marginalized population or, you know, other tropes are the insane patients. And, you know, you can still have a scene that's set in a institution, but maybe the patients are revolting. And so it's flipping that power dynamic so that you're not punching down. And I think that's good for not only society as a whole, but it does allow guests to stay engaged and immersed, because nothing takes you out of a scene like being reminded of, you know, just crappy stuff that you're there to forget about, or, you know, that you're there to kind of feel a sense of control over. So I know that a lot of haunts are probably going to be doing political stuff this fall, and I'm curious to see how they're doing that and how guests are going to respond. A lot of times we go to these types of experiences to escape reality, to feel a sense of control we don't have in everyday life. So I don't know if people are going to want to engage with that in haunted attractions, but maybe they do. I'm definitely going to try and find out. So,
well, that's fascinating. I'm wondering, you know, I assume, like a lot of things, the average person has a limit for how much fear they want to willingly expose themselves to.
Yeah. And when I look at consumer market research across the years, attendance at haunted attractions has actually gone up during times of war, like during Gulf War and the second and the Iraq War. So, you know, I think that, and more research definitely needs to be done on this, because most of this is just coming from consumer market research and then me making hypotheses based on, you know, sociology, you know, theory and movements, but that they're doing that because there is a heightened state of anxiety and stress. And in haunted attractions, you can feel a sense of immediacy around that tension and a sense of closure. That's my hypothesis. I don't know if.
Wow, that's almost the opposite where I thought I was going to go. I was wondering, you know, if people are just living in fear of change or the government falling apart or not being able to take America back, depending on whatever side you're on, if they're already cranked up with fear that they would not go to a haunted house. But you're saying in times of war, the attendance goes up.
Yeah. And I think, though, that this is a strange American thing, because when I was in Bogota and going to attractions there, there aren't many haunted attractions at all. In fact, they were only in tourist amusement parks. The historians, the political scientists, the psychologists that I talked to there all said, no, the horror genre is not popular here. You know, people, they don't want to engage with it because they get enough of it in the news and enough of it in the very real street violence that's present in everyday life. And so I thought, oh, well, that's a really great kind of hypothesis. You know, places that have high rates of actual violence have low engagement with symbolic violence or haunted attractions, scary movies. But then, you know, you have the U.S. that has this strange paradoxical relationship. And then there's other countries like Mexico, too, that have, you know, high rates of both. But I don't know. I'm wondering if maybe, you know, if I were able to get all the data in the world, I could find some patterns that would explain that paradox. But I agree. It was a surprising statistic for me to see with the war and increased attendance. So, yeah.
I'm just wondering if someone could make a haunted house and at some point you get to choose how the story continues.
Oh, I love that. I love choose your own adventure haunted house. Oh, yeah.
Okay, so this is not Phil's original idea. So my thought was you go through the haunted house and then at some point you get to choose whether you're pro-Trump or anti-Trump. And if you know, depending on what you choose, you get the scariest scenario that those people might feel like, and they get to be heroes. I don't know if that's just too messed up or if that might actually work for people.
I don't know. It's, certainly would make for an interesting parking lot afterwards.
Well, and I would be afraid that it would reinforce the stereotypes that maybe many sides already have to quote Herr Trump.
Probably, I would imagine so.
That's interesting. Now, something that my listeners might be more interested, or not more, but also interested in, have you ever been to the religiously themed haunted houses?
The Hell Houses. You know, I've never been through one myself, but I did, you know, I've seen the documentaries and I've talked to people. I went to college in southwestern Virginia and was near Lynchburg, where Jerry Falwell's school is. And talked to people who had been through their hell houses, and they just sound absolutely horrifying, but not in the fun way. What was really problematic about them too is that they often will use kids. They have kids who act out these, you know, really horrendous scenes of suicide and abortion and adultery, and it just sounds awful.
Yeah, it sounds like, you know, a puppet master using the local youth group to live out their sick fantasies and put it on display, and then at the end when you say, but if you come to Jesus, it's all going to be okay. It's like anything can be forgiven, no matter how terrible it is, if you just throw Jesus in at the end.
I know. I always had a problem with that growing up. I never understood the whole idea that as long as you ask for forgiveness, you can get away with whatever you want. You don't have to feel bad at all. It's like, that can't be a real thing.
Well, it's funny because now that I'm talking about it, I remember I heard about one where it actually did have a choice at the end where it phrased it in such a way, you know, that do you acknowledge that you've done things wrong, blah, 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 blah. And they send you into a room and they start breaking you up into smaller and smaller groups to try to get you to confess and accept Jesus right there on the spot as you're scared. And if you answer the question the other way, you're clearly not likely to be responding to that, and you just exit. And you exit the haunted house. So what we probably need to do, Margee, is get you to go to a couple of these and write a book about it. What do you think?
I think that's a great idea. I'm putting that on my list too, because I bet that there will be an uptick in hell houses in this political climate.
Well, yeah, I can see a political hell house, you know, where you go to some place like Boston or Seattle, where you predictably have few Trump supporters, and, you know, you have in there, you know, scenes with Nazis and the KKK and people losing their ability to get married and gays being, you know, imprisoned, and just you can let your imagination go. And some people would just be horrified by that, but other people wouldn't consider it scary at all, but would be thankful and happy.
Yeah. I have seen some Trump masks and some of the props, the Halloween style props. I mean, the Trump mask is, I think, going to be a popular Halloween item, but seeing how it's used, that'll be interesting.
Well, it was fascinating to me. I recently moved to a Chicago suburb called New Lenox, and I've coined that it's the Bible Belt of Chicago, because I moved up here thinking it's Chicagoland. It's like most modern cities, you know, very open and but it's not. It's a very small town on the fringe of the suburbs, and I had to ask the neighbors, why do you have one blue light and one white light by your garage door? Do you know why that is?
Why?
So you didn't know either. Because it shows that they support the police.
I did not know that.
Yeah. And I'm like, well, who doesn't support the police?
That everybody who doesn't support the police?
Well, and I'm sure that there's plenty of people that are just wonderful, delightful people, and they either are or know someone in the police, and that became a symbol for them to show their support, and I'm all for it. But then there are others, and I don't know what the mix is, there are others who put these up as saying, you know what, if it comes down to black lives or blue lives, I'm going with the blue lives, and I want to make sure everybody knows where I stand on this issue.
Yeah, that's what's been so challenging for me as a teacher, as an educator too, is to see when the proxy symbols start coming in that people can say, well, no, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that I support police. This blue light does not mean that XYZ. When it does, you know, when they are making a very clear statement about what that says about their beliefs, and yes, they support, you know, cops, but when they start using it as a proxy to hide behind, I get really frustrated, because then it's hard to have an honest conversation, you know, and that's,
Well, while we're on this weird tangent, I also had one of my neighbors put up a flag that it's the American flag, and normal American flag in every way, except for one of the middle white horizontal lines is replaced by a blue line.
Huh.
And it's the same kind of thing.
Same thing.
Yeah, that you know, they support the blue cops. And it's funny because I think people put way too much value on flags, period.
Yeah, yeah.
But yet it still bothered me.
Yeah.
I don't know, but I don't know if you have any thoughts on that or not. But
well, we do. We love flags. I just was teaching 12 Japanese exchange students who were in the U.S. just for a week, and asking them what they found weird about the U.S. and what was surprising. And, you know, the number of flags and the attention to flags was one of those things that we just, we really, you know, our flags are everywhere. And that was something I had never thought about, that that was different than in other places. But it has made me think about our use of flags and where they are a lot more.
Well, it's interesting because for many years I've been involved with Rotary Youth Exchange, international exchange between other countries around the world. And when students come from other countries to the United States, a couple things shock them. One, that Nutella is not readily available everywhere all the time. They're not really used to peanut butter. And they've never seen fake cheese, liquid cheese, like for nachos or out of a can. And they consider that to be not cheese. And I think there's a point to that. But they also get very bothered by, and some families do this on purpose, where the host parents will require them to go to their church.
Oh.
And they came from a secular country or a different religion, but the parents see it as an opportunity to indoctrinate them, which kind of offends me.
Yeah, yeah. It's one thing to, you know, visit different churches to get an idea of culture, but it's another to try and convert somebody while they're visiting.
Absolutely. So now, do you have another book in process, or?
Well, I am. I'm working with a co-writer in London, and we are in the middle of working up a proposal that's going to take a look at pain in a similar fashion, just really looking at it from lots of different angles, you know, a historical angle. Definitely culture plays a huge role in the meaning of pain, but with an eye on how, you know, our relationship to pain in the U.S. has changed so much and not in entirely the best way. So, yeah, we're working on that. It's, you know, it's we both have, you know, daytime jobs, so it's kind of slow going, but we're both excited about it and hoping to get it moving along.
Now, you don't know this, of course, but a recent show I just had on someone talking about opioids, which is something to theoretically, at least in the short run, reduce pain. Is that going to be something even tangentially that you had thought about covering in the book?
Yeah, we're going to look at that and how, you know, our attempt to just destroy pain has left us hurting all the more. And there were these promises of what opioids could do, and that just were misplaced. And a lot of the research shows that they don't work the way I guess what's more accurate is they've been prescribed in ways that are not actually helpful for us, for a majority of the people for whom they're prescribed. And, you know, I think that that's a real shame. And I am glad that there's more attention being brought to the pharmaceutical companies and their roles in that. The book Dreamland, I really recommend. It's such a great, great book, just really well written. And it's Sam, I forget how to say his last name, but I think it's Quinn, maybe, but you know, that looks at both the spread of opioid use and heroin, and how, you know, if you're talking about drug dealers or doctors prescribing, it's that the line between them is blurry in terms of responsibility.
Yeah, people will seek out what their body tells them to find. So,
yeah,
that's unfortunate. But so your book that's out now is Scream, and it's available at all good booksellers, hardback and paperback, with the bright red comic cartoony cover, which is very, very colorful. I like that a lot. And I even see that it's an audiobook.
It is. And I read the audiobook, which was a whole new challenge. And I have a lot of respect for the voice actors who do that for a living, because it is hard and definitely a talent. That was actually really fun. When I was recording the audiobook, I got to meet one of the voice actors, and she was able to go through like 5 different American accents within a paragraph. And it was the coolest thing I'd ever heard, going from like Southern accent to, you know, to Northern, to Boston, to, you know, like North Dakota. It was awesome.
And was she doing this just to show off her skills, or was that something you needed in your book?
Oh, just to show off. I just asked her. I asked her how many accents she could do.
I've seen people do that, and some of them are quite impressive.
Yeah, it is very cool.
Well, is there anything we haven't covered that we need to tell the listeners about?
I don't think so. If anybody wants to follow me on Twitter and Instagram, it's just Margee Kerr, and that's my website too, so I'm pretty easy to find.
Well, that's fantastic. Well, Margee, thank you so much for your time, and I appreciate you being on The Phil Ferguson Show.
Well, thank you. Good to be here.
What if you're wrong?
Well, what if I'm wrong? I mean, anybody could be wrong. We could all be wrong about the flying spaghetti monster and the pink unicorn and the flying teapot. You happen to have been brought up, I would presume, in the Christian faith. You know what it's like not to believe in a particular faith because you're not a Muslim. You're not a Hindu. Why aren't you a Hindu? Because you happen to have been brought up in America, not in India. If you'd been brought up in India, you'd be a Hindu. If you were brought up in Denmark in the time of the Vikings, you'd be believing in Wotan and Thor. If you were brought up in classical Greece, you'd be believing in Zeus. If you were brought up in Central Africa, you'd be believing in the great Juju up the mountain. I mean, there's no particular reason to pick on the Judeo-Christian God in which, by the sheerest accident, you happen to have been brought up and ask me the question, what if I'm wrong? What if you're wrong about the great Juju at the bottom of the sea?
You're listening to The Phil Ferguson Show.
That part of the show where we get to wrap things up, and there was so much going on right now that I forgot one of my emails I wanted to cover today. Someone had sent me a link about Congress considering to change a little bit of how 401ks work, and they have toyed around with this idea of 401ks being all taxed, or at least new money being taxed, kind of like Roth 401ks. And a lot of people now have the option for lack of a better word, traditional 401k, where you get to deduct the money from your taxes and then pay taxes later, or Roth 401k, where you get no deduction now, but you never pay tax in the future. And the reason for this is the same reason that they created Roth IRAs, and it might be in your best interest, or it might not. But why the politicians love this little game is that if you're putting $10,000 into your 401k and you don't have to pay tax on it, the government makes no tax revenue. Let's say your tax is 30%. They don't get to charge you $3,000 on the taxes. If it becomes a Roth 401k, they can get $3,000 in the taxes and you don't ever have to pay taxes in the future, 10, 20, 30 years down the road, which might or might not cause a problem with the budget. But the politician is only looking for the next election. And so their goal is to figure out how to not go into more debt, if they care about that at all, but how to bring in more money and make it not seem like they're making taxes on you, which they're just changing when you're taxed. So it's a short-term solution to a long-term problem. And they're not fixing by reducing spending. They're not fixing by increasing taxes or improving efficiencies or making some other systematic solution to the system. They're simply collecting more tax now and less tax in the future, which means the problem might be bigger in the future. But as long as they can get elected in a year or two or four or five or six or eight or 12 or whatever, they don't seem to really care. So that's something we're going to keep an eye on. And once again, that is the United States government thinking about making 401k Roth 401ks. Or making them more easy or making them even required. I don't know. It's one of those things when we talk about the tax rules are what they are today. And they can always change. As an example, Social Security, when it was originally paid out, was not taxed. And then some of it was, and then some more of it was, and then more of it is, and it's complicated. Same thing could happen. You could put money into a Roth IRA today and get no tax benefit today, but be told that you'll never pay tax in the future unless they change the rules. And they might change the rules to say, we're going to charge you when you take money out of the Roth IRA in your retirement just 10% on the growth. Or they could say it's ordinary income. Or they're going to say you pay whatever the capital gains rate is, and then they increase the capital gains rate. Anything's possible. It's all based on a vote. So, you know, it's one of those questions when people ask me all the time, what's better, an IRA or a Roth IRA? And we've had longer discussions on it, and I'm not going to go into it now, but who knows? So it depends on the realities of your income and what might happen to taxes. It looks like I don't have any new reviews at either iTunes or Stitcher. So I have the sads. So that's kind of a bummer. If you like the show, please go leave me a review at iTunes or Stitcher. Of course, either place would be fine. A couple other fun things in my world. This weekend, the couple days after you're hearing this show, I am going to be the DJ for a wedding. It's a niece of mine is getting married. And I'm honestly thinking that after this, I may sell all of my old DJ equipment so I can't get volunteered again. Although in this case, I'm avoiding a lot of other things that other people are doing because I'm the DJ. So who knows? It's going to be great fun, but it also means, you know, once the reception starts and then the ceremony starts, I'm going to be working all night long where a lot of the other people are going to be finished with their work and they get to enjoy the party. But it's still going to be fun. I mean, really, I'm not kidding anybody. And of course, the following week will be Freedom From Religion Foundation. Again, I do expect to be there. There is a small possibility that I won't be able to make it. That's in Madison, Wisconsin, and it's so close. I'd hate to miss it. A lot of great speakers. Go check that out. Freedom From Religion Foundation, FFRF, as it's often known. I do expect to be there. And I think that's about it for now. So I hope to see you somewhere soon. Until then, ciao.